Good to see you here this morning on our second Sunday of Advent, and welcome if you're watching our live stream at home. The theme for this service is the word is light. We're focusing on first chapter of John's Gospel over these 3 weeks, and last week we looked at the word is life, and this week it's the word is light. You've been able to give your gifts for the gift service outside already, and my other announcement to make is that there's still time to book. There's still some tickets to book if you want to join in with the journey for Christmas next Saturday. It's best if you can do it through Eventbrite. It's not terribly complicated. You just need your name, your surname, and your email. If you do struggle, then please drop me a wee email, and then I'll book it for you. And those who are involved in the actual scenes, I think they're trying on costumes after the service, and there is a run-through on Wednesday morning for those who are around, or else the general rehearsal is Saturday morning at 10:30. So I'm looking forward to that. The choir will lead us into worship by singing the Introit. Well, it's time to light the Advent candles, and we're going to get some help with that this morning. And it's two candles today. To use the matches. It's just that I think it's old. I just need to get another. Thank you. I have a different response today. It's really simple. It's just, we are seeking light. So I will say something and then you say, we are seeking light. In this season of waiting, of longing, of looking for you to come into our world, we are seeking light. In our own lives, we are seeking light. In our neighborhoods, we are seeking light. In our families, we are seeking light. In our work, we are seeking light. In our world, we are seeking light. The Bible says, seek and you shall find. Knock and the door will be opened. Ask and it will be given to you. Jesus Christ, you are the light of the world. May we have eyes to see you and ears to hear you. Come into our world today. Let us sing together, Come, Thou Long Expected Jesus. Let us pray. Lord, as we gather for worship this morning, we come looking for light. Help us to see it when you hold it out for us. Open our eyes to see. We confess that we are often blind to your presence and your light. We don't go looking for it. We know, we have heard, Jesus is the light of the world, and yet we do not fix our gaze on him when we are surrounded by darkness. Instead, we go and focus on artificial lights or focus on the darkness instead. Help us to read and understand your word. It is a lamp for our feet and a light on our path. Help us to sense the presence of your Holy Spirit with us, guiding us through life into your kingdom. We pray with Jesus the prayer that he taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done. On earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our first reading today is from Isaiah 9, 1 to 7. And Anne will be reading for us.
This is from the New International Version. Nevertheless, there will be no more gloom for those who were in distress. In the past, he humbled the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in the future, he will honor Galilee of the nations, by the way of the sea beyond the Jordan. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as warriors rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning, will be fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness, from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. Amen.
We are going to sing Christ is our light. That's hymn 336. Our second reading is from John chapter 1, verses 1 to 10.
The Word became flesh. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was God with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life. And that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gave light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. Amen, and may God bless these readings of his holy word, and to his name be the glory.
Thank you, Anne. And the choir will now sing the anthem.
Thank you.
wonder if you've ever walked in the dark or when it's nearly dark. What about you, Hunter? Do you ever walk in the dark? What would you need if you were going out, you know, just before the sun has gone down and it's getting a little bit tricky to see, Tabitha? Yeah, you might need a torch or a head torch. And if you're going out with a dog, then you might want to put them in a wee flashy collar too. And maybe, to be seen by the traffic, you might want to put on a reflective vest. Now, we do have all that gear because we have Asher, our yellow Labrador, to walk. And when the days are so short as they are now, you know, sometimes towards the end of the afternoon or the beginning of the evening, you still have to give him a second walk and just make sure you're safe and you can be seen and you can see yourself. Now, a few days ago, I went out, I guess around four, maybe a wee bit later when it was really starting to get dark, but hadn't brought all the gear, and I was kind of already too far up Clevens Road to turn back in and get it. So I thought, well, it's all right, I'll just carry on. It does help that he's quite pale, so you can see him quite easily, even if there's just a little bit of light. And I wasn't really planning on doing what we call the big loop, which is going through the practice field. It's not quite the same as doing Barn Beth, but it's kind of doing that in the fields, and you end up at the top of St. Andrew's Drive. But it does go through the fields, past the bog, through another field, down a lane. Anyway, that's the official description, the big loop. So I hadn't planned to do the big loop. I thought I would just walk into the field and back. But as I was going, I was kind of enjoying myself and actually found that I still had enough light to see. And I could still, even though really there wasn't, you know, much light left, I could still see in front of me, and the path was a little bit lighter, and there was still things to reflect the last of the sunshine. Now, if I had been at home, sitting in the house, looking outside, I would have thought, oh, it's really dark. Couldn't go out in this, you know, without bringing a torch or something. But while I was walking, I actually found there was still enough light to place one foot in front of the other. And as I was walking, I reflected how sometimes in life that can be the way. If we're looking out at a problem or a situation, maybe somebody else's problem or somebody else's situation, or even your own, you think, oh, I can't possibly deal with this. I can't possibly set another foot in front of another. It's overwhelming. It's too dark. It's too complicated. I can't find my way forward. And yet when you're in that situation, and sometimes you just have, you know, you can't avoid it, you're in it, and actually you find just one step at a time, there is still enough light to take the next step ahead of you and to keep walking. We may not be able to see the full path ahead, but we can still see enough to take the next step. Now, you probably by this point have received our joint Christmas card that we always distribute with lots of willing volunteers and pop through all the doors, through all the houses in the village. And this year, we chose this text, which is taken from John chapter 1. In him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. That is one of my favorite verses in the Bible. There is so much darkness in the world, and sometimes in our own lives, and even in our own selves too. And it can be overwhelming and frightening. And yet this verse is so full of hope. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. Confidence and hope. It is real about darkness, but it's also real about the light. Now, John has started his gospel in quite a poetic or philosophical manner. Last week we looked at the word is life. Now, the Greek word that he uses here is logos, You might recognize it from things like biology and theology. The logos bit means word or reason. So John uses that word, logos, for word, and it would have evoked all sorts of different ideas for different people. Now, to the Jews, God's word, as we talked about last week, is creative. When God speaks, it happens. So it's a creative word. It stands, logos, for the creative power of God. To the Greeks, it would have been associated with reason or order, and sometimes also associated with the gods in that way, divine reason that orders all of life. If you know the logos, you kind of have a way of looking into the mind of God, if you like. It was a very rich and meaningful concept, which is probably why John uses it. But John isn't trying to write philosophy. He is introducing us to a person of Jesus Christ. He is the Word, the Logos, made flesh. And this Word, this person, is the light of the world. So these two abstract concepts, Word and light, they become a person, and it's Jesus. Now, the image of light speaks to probably all of humanity, as we all depend on light for life. We need it to see. We need it to live. We need it for plants to grow, and so on. We can't live without light. And the darkness, on the other hand, often can hold a danger and a threat. So the image of darkness versus light, we pretty much find in all world religions. And even people who don't have a religion would still kind of resonate with the imagery of darkness and light. But again, John's words are not just generic religious spiritual writing. They are very specific. Jesus, he says, is the light coming into the world. And so even though the imagery is universal, everyone can understand it, his claim is very specific. Jesus is it. He is the light of the world. And you have to respond to him, to what he says, to what he does, the person he is. You have to believe in him, what he says, and what he does, and who he is. And that's really something that comes right throughout John's Gospel, and we'll be looking at John's Gospel all the way to Easter, so you'll have plenty of opportunities to reflect on this, but it's all about Jesus and who Jesus is. So if you do believe in Jesus and listen to what he says and follow his example and trust in him, then you receive the light and you can walk in the light. Jesus, the creative Word of God, has come to the world he created to be its light, to guide it out of darkness, and to overcome the darkness. But then, even in this introduction that John sketches for us, the tragedy is this. He was the true light that gives light to everyone coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. So John has perfectly set the scene, the introduction for the rest of his gospel. There's this tension of everything that Jesus is, life and light and everything good, God himself. And yet this, he came to that which was his own, and his own did not receive him. The light came into the world, but was rejected. People didn't want to know. This is a theme that John will wrestle with throughout his gospel. Jesus came to the holy, the set-aside people of God to be their long-awaited Savior, as Isaiah had promised, and others, a light piercing their darkness, as we heard. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light, and those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. Finally, it's here. And yet, the tragedy was that many did not receive him. They did not believe what he said or that he came from God. In fact, some did try to overcome him, overcome the light, seize him and have him killed. They tried to extinguish the light of the world. Now, we need to bear in mind this was said by John, who was, of course, a Jew himself, as was Jesus, about the Jewish people of the day. And, of course, it wasn't everyone, because Jesus had disciples, and from there the church grew. But it was a tragic mystery to him, as it would be to the Apostle Paul. But it wasn't the final message. John says that the light is not overcome by the darkness. And Jesus' rejection by some or by many does not stop all those who do receive the light that is Jesus to become the children of God. What that means, we'll look at next week. The good news is that God will have his way with the world. God will and does create life through his word. And God will and does shine light into darkness. The darkness will not overcome it. Jesus is it, the life, the light. And we have a choice. Will we receive it? Will we receive him this Christmas? If we do, we will find we can walk in the light, no matter how dark it is around us. We will walk in the light of Jesus, trusting in his presence with us and in his victory over darkness and death. There will be no more gloom for those who were in distress, as Isaiah said. Amen. We're going to sing hymn 543, Longing for Light, We Wait in Darkness. Let us sit. We're going to pray, and we're going to pray a blessing over the gifts. They're not in front of us because of COVID and make it easier. They're in Dennis and Mary's car, but we're going to pray over these gifts and the families that will receive them. Let us pray. God, you give us light and life, and we thank you for it. We give these gifts that we've gathered and pray a blessing over them. May they bring some joy and light into families helped by the Paisley Salvation Army this year. We pray for a blessing on the children and the young people that receive them. May they see something of the light and love of Christ for them. Heavenly Father, we know that darkness is not a thing of the past. Many in this world feel that their world is one of darkness and gloom. Through bereavement, illness, money worries, family trouble, pressures at work or unemployment, drugs, drink, all sorts of things that trouble us. Gracious and living God, we rejoice that you are with us in our troubles. You know us and you love us always. And even though we make a mess of things personally and collectively, you remain faithful. And we rejoice that your Son came not to a perfect world, but to a broken world, our world, to bring light to the darkness, our darkness. And so we pray for our dark and dreary world, a world in need, not just of technical fixes, but in need of love and grace, forgiveness and new life, hope, peace, and fellowship, in need of renewal, in need of you. We pray that you would come alongside us and all those for whom we pray, that you would show us Jesus, the light of the world, the one who came and the one who comes to rid us of sin, to give us life and well-being, peace that passes all understanding, and ultimately life eternal. We have been set free. Enable us to use our freedom to share in bringing in the kingdom. In the light of this, we have something to celebrate, something to shout about. For even in our trouble and pain, even in our loss, we know that Jesus is with us. And there is enough light for us to walk our journey, one step at a time. Hear us as in a moment of silence we pray for those that are in our hearts and on our minds. The Lord is my light and salvation. Hear our prayers, Lord, spoken and unspoken, and answer them for Jesus' sake. Amen. After the service, you can stay for coffee and tea downstairs and the outfits, just a wee reminder as well. We're going to sing our final hymn, 473, Thy Kingdom Come on Bended Knee. from here, walking in the light of Christ. And go with the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.